A kidney transplant survivor gets a new lease on life and love.
He saw a second chance, and it was just life-changing for him. He really loved being with her, and he felt that they really clicked.
They both looked at life like, you only live once.
Words that would prove darkly prophetic when their budding romance is torn apart by a horrific crime.
911, what is the emergency?
My son, the red rock, and he's beat him up. That's not sure. He's okay.
Is he breathing?
He's cold. He's cold. He's cold.
This was a violent crime scene. There was obviously a struggle.
I said, oh my God, my baby.
As detectives hunt for the assailant, disturbing truths are dragged into the light.
They were vying for the same girl.
To solve the mystery, they'll have to expose a plot for revenge that's as ruthless as it is twisted.
She implied she would have people take care of him.
How can you predict something like that?
December 5th, 2014. It's a cold Friday evening in Silver Spring, Maryland, and residents are just beginning to arrive home from the daily grind.
The community that we live in is a very safe neighborhood.
As working mother Patricia Harris pulls into her driveway, she notices the car belonging to her 26-year-old son, Jonathan, is still parked out front.
Her adult son, Jonathan Harris, lives in a basement apartment connected to her home.
I was a little surprised, because he usually go to where he worked as a pizza delivery man.
Hey, Jonathan, I thought you were at work. Well, I see your car outside, but it doesn't look like you're home. I was just making sure everything is okay. I love you, sweetie.
He had health issues, and the kind of mother Pat is, she was always there and always nurturing him.
Though they lived just a few feet away from each other, Patricia made sure to respect Jonathan's privacy and independence.
He was an adult. She gave him space.
She tried to make it a habit never to go to his apartment uninvited or without contact.
But as the night drags on with no word from Jonathan, Patricia's worries continue to mount.
I called again. I called all night long.
He wasn't responding, and she knew that something was wrong. That was not like him.
Maybe it's a health issue.
By 10:30 a.m. the next morning, Patricia still hasn't heard from Jonathan.
I said, all bets are off. I'm going down, and he's going to have to deal with me.
At the bottom of the stairs, Patricia finds her son's apartment door slightly ajar.
John? Jonathan, are you in there?
As she pushes it open, Patricia comes face to face with every parent's worst nightmare.
I found him on the floor. I said, oh, my God. My baby.
There was a small pool of blood on the floor where he had been lying. It looked like there was a robbery that had taken place.
It is quite apparent that there has been some form of a struggle that has occurred. It's pretty apparent to her that someone has come in, left the door ajar, and removed multiple items from his apartment.
I called 911.
Montgomery County 911, what is the emergency?
My son, he's fallen into the red rock and was beaten up. That's not sure. He's okay, please, just okay.
As paramedics and police rush to the scene, Patricia's mind begins to race.
I could not believe it. I kept praying.
My mother didn't know what happened. Who would do that to him?
What happened? Who did it? All I cared about is what happened to Jonathan.
Jonathan Harris grew up in a warm and loving household with his mother, Patricia, and older brother, Lloyd.
The three of us lived in the same house, and we had this bond. My mother is my everything. My brother was my everything. A lot of love in our house.
Though small in stature, Jonathan charmed everyone with his larger-than-life personality.
My brother was the star of the cul-de-sac. People didn't even call me by my name. I was Jonathan's brother.
He made everybody feel like they're the greatest thing that ever happened. Whenever he would meet someone, it wasn't long before they were Jonathan's friends.
My mother was Jonathan's mother. I would be sent to look for him. I'd have to knock on all the doors, and of course he'd be right in someone's house, like eating dinner, you know, just carrying on. He was just the funnest.
He loved to dance. just randomly outburst. He would just do a moonwalk.
He knew how to bring the best out of people because he was the best at being himself.
Not that life had always been easy for Jonathan. At the tender age of 12, doctors diagnosed him with kidney failure.
The doctor found out that Jonathan was born with one kidney and that it had failed.
Though Jonathan had seemed like a healthy, normal kid, in hindsight, there had been clues to his condition.
Some days he was fine, but then other days I could see the fluid accumulating in his body.
When we found out about his kidney issues, as we look back, there was symptoms and clues there the whole time. He was always very frail. He was the smallest kid in class. You know, you just chalk it off as like, oh, he's just maturing slower than everyone.
In the time it had taken to diagnose Jonathan, his condition had rapidly declined.
It was like 0 to 60 in 2.2 seconds. One moment he was sick, and the next moment he was dying. I just remember that day so vividly. I had to carry him and put him in the back seat, and I'd never seen him so frail and defenseless and weak. And I mean, I did everything I could just to not break down.
I looked at Jonathan hooked up to this big machine, and I said, God, this is the worst thing that has ever happened to me. And I need you to take care of this for me. I give it over to you.
Thankfully, Jonathan's condition stabilized. And after 2 years of dialysis, he finally received a transplant from his own brother.
He said, I'm gonna give him a kidney.
As someone who loves him more than anything else in this world, if there's something I can do, I'm gonna do it.
I was shocked, but that's that bond from the childhood that the two of them had.
It wasn't even a decision that was made. It just was something that I knew I needed to do. I would hope that's what anyone would do if they saw someone they loved in a situation like that. I remember coming home from the hospital, and he's running around the house, and he went outside to play, and it's like it never happened. I was also super happy for him because he had been wanting that for so long. It was awesome. He made up for all the sleepovers he couldn't go to because he has his dialysis. He came to visit me in New York, and man, we tore that city up. He killed life. He killed it.
Unfortunately, the family's happiness was short-lived. 4 years later, during Jonathan's senior year, the kidney Lloyd had given him began to fail.
It went into rejection, and they couldn't turn it around. And the only thing Jonathan could think of was, Mom, how am I gonna tell Lloyd? I said, well, John, you just gotta tell him. It's no big deal. So he called Lloyd and he said, Lloyd, I lost your kidney.
I think he felt bad because he lost it. And I told him I don't care.
Though the news was heartbreaking, Jonathan never let his situation get his spirits down.
He'd already ordered his cap and gown because, you know, he was a senior.
Walking across the stage was really important for Jonathan. He wanted to finish high school.
He could barely walk. He was frail, but he got to walk. That just sort of symbolized that he was like everyone else, and I think he needed that.
When he marched across that stage, there wasn't a dry eye in my family.
There's a picture of him with his best friend, Mark, and he is just the biggest smile I've ever seen.
Ultimately, after years of dialysis and surgeries to salvage the transplanted kidney, Jonathan's mother found another way to save her son.
Hey, Mom. How you feeling?
I'm doing good.
I do my research, and I found out about the kidney exchange. So I went to the doctor.
His mother donated in what was, at the time, the biggest kidney swap in the history of the United States, where 16 recipients and 16 donors swapped kidneys.
They tested me. They tested Jonathan. And they went through that whole process of matching individuals.
My mother gave some random stranger her kidney, and some random woman gave my brother a kidney. It was a success.
In a matter of months, he really became just like all his friends.
Now 22 years old, Jonathan was finally healthy and thriving.
He had a job, he went to school. It was just amazing.
During that time, Jonathan began to yearn for more independence.
He still was on a lot of medication, and my mother, she needed to be around.
His mother came up with the solution that they would make a basement apartment for him.
Patricia and Jonathan established boundaries so he'd have plenty of privacy.
The rule was, if you want to come down, Mom, you call. If I say this is not the time, you don't come.
She was able to do that for him so he can have his own space, so he can have his friends over, so he can have his own little parties.
With a space of his own, Jonathan could also focus on his creative passion, rap music.
Jonathan was really into music, making music. And he'd write about everything from girls to his history, his story. He had a real story, you know, he came from a real struggle. His music was his outlet to really say what he was thinking. Maybe that's why he got so deep into making music, because that was his therapy. And when I would listen back on some of the music, it was all these things that I didn't know. And I thought he told me everything. He was going to open mic nights and performing wherever he could.
3 years later, with his own apartment, a steady job, and a clean bill of health, Jonathan's future was brighter than ever. There was just one thing missing.
He really wanted to find a person who he can just enjoy life with.
That's what any normal person wants at that time in their life. He deserves someone.
And when a mutual friend introduced Jonathan to gorgeous and outgoing 25-year-old Samantha Parker, it was as if Jonathan had been hit by Cupid's arrow.
When they met, I mean, they vibed very well. They just clicked.
You are gorgeous.
Thank you.
From the beginning, Jonathan was captivated by Samantha's joie de vivre.
They both looked at life like you only live once.
She was really on the edge and really adventurous.
Like Jonathan, Samantha had also overcome a difficult childhood.
Samantha and her mom didn't necessarily get along too well. And so that kind of mother-daughter relationship was very estranged in a sense. So in her father, they weren't as close as far as I remember. So that mother-daughter and that father-daughter relationship just wasn't there.
And in the spring of 2014, after less than a year of dating, Jonathan asked Samantha to take the next big step in their relationship.
Samantha actually moved in with Jonathan. He saw a future with Samantha and that she may be the one going forward.
He really loved her and he would do anything for her.
But the discovery of Jonathan's lifeless body has brought his budding relationship with Samantha to a tragic end. And when the truth of who killed Jonathan is revealed, it will be equally as horrifying.
It's devastating. It's crazy. Still shook about it.
After a lifetime of health problems, 26-year-old Maryland native Jonathan Harris had survived not one, but two kidney transplants.
He was about achieving. He was about making it happen. It's like he started to live when that second kidney started to work.
And with a steady job, a place of his own, and his girlfriend Samantha Parker by his side, life was good.
She's beautiful and she cares about him. She was everything he always wanted.
But on December 5th, 2014, Jonathan's life is cut short in unimaginable fashion.
Montgomery County 911, what is the emergency?
My son, the man robbed him and beat him up. I'm not sure if he's okay. Please, just okay.
Okay, is he breathing?
He's cold. Please go. Go.
First responders rush to the scene. When they arrive, they discover Jonathan on the ground, motionless and unresponsive.
EMTs assess Jonathan's vitals, and he doesn't have any.
They said, Ms. Harris, we hate to tell you this, but he didn't make it. I could not believe it. All I wanted to do was kiss him, kiss him, kiss him, but I couldn't touch him.
As Jonathan's body is transported to the medical examiner's office, homicide detectives arrive on the scene and are brought up to speed. Meanwhile, news of Jonathan's death begins to spread.
This was someone who I knew since I was 10. My best friend was taken from me. It's devastating. It's crazy.
I just was lost in that moment. I lost the most important person to me.
There was obviously a struggle.
There was pooling of blood inside his eyeballs consistent with asphyxiation.
Men basically strangled her or smothered.
Judging by the apartment's state of disarray, robbery seems like the obvious motive.
You could see that a TV had been pulled off a wall in the living room. The bedroom had been rummaged through.
This is either some kind of burglary or robbery in connection with the murder.
Had Jonathan Harris truly been the victim of a random burglary, or was the attack more personal in nature?
There was no forced entry into the residence. It suggests that Jonathan knew the person, or the person had access to Jonathan's apartment.
But who among Jonathan's friends and neighbors would have any reason to attack him?
We didn't know why anyone would want to hurt Jonathan.
To better answer that question, investigators turned to Jonathan's grieving mother, Patricia Harris.
Mrs. Harris, sorry to bother you, but in order to find out what happened to Jonathan, we need to ask a few questions.
I want to do whatever I can.
Can you think of anyone that would want to hurt Jonathan?
No, not at all. Everybody loved Jonathan. He was a good boy.
She described her son as well-loved, lots of friends.
Very caring, very generous, very nice person. This is a guy who just did not have enemies.
She couldn't imagine why anybody would want to do him harm.
Detectives pressed Patricia for more information about his personal life.
Did Jonathan have a girlfriend?
Yes, his girlfriend, Samantha. Well, she was his girlfriend anyways.
What do you mean was?
That's when Jonathan's mother offers up a piece of information about her son that not even his closest friends were aware of. Information that adds a new wrinkle to the case.
She moved in here with Jonathan and she moved out after they broke up.
When was that?
About 2 weeks ago. Came as a shock to me. He seemed happy, but Jonathan just said it was one of those things.
Jonathan said they had gone their separate ways. The relationship had run its course.
Do you know Samantha's contact info?
No, I'm sorry, I don't.
Patricia says that as part of their agreement to give Jonathan his space, she didn't interact with Samantha unless invited.
He introduced me. He told me that she was moving in, but I'm trying to treat my son like a man. I saw her one time in about 3 months.
Detectives know the next step to understanding what happened to Jonathan is tracking down Samantha Parker.
A lot of times detectives look into significant others first because they can offer some sort of insight into their lives that no one else can. Also, the significant other may have an axe to grind.
Maybe she was involved, or maybe she knew about some trouble Jonathan had with someone.
Without a phone number or address for Samantha, law enforcement has difficulty finding her.
They were hoping they could track her down by checking in with some of Jonathan's friends.
While patrol officers reach out to Jonathan's friends for more intel on Samantha Parker, detectives ask Jonathan's mother to help them determine exactly what's missing from her son's apartment.
The first thing I remember was his TV, his gaming system, and his cell phone. I don't think he had his wallet on.
The fact that Jonathan's wallet is missing provides a potential lead for detectives.
If his wallet's not there, then we want to start looking into bank information to see if, since he's been discovered, has his card been used.
All right. Thank you, Ms. Harris. We really appreciate your cooperation.
Detectives radio into headquarters and request a subpoena for Jonathan's credit card records. Back outside, a young man approaches officers.
Excuse me, officer.
Yes, sir. Can I help you?
My name is Mark Newitt. I'm friends with Jonathan.
I actually saw ambulance and police tape outside around his house. I didn't know what was going on. Neighbors were saying that Jonathan had been killed.
Mark says he's a close friend of Jonathan's.
I was just really in disbelief that, you know, one of my best friends had passed away.
But it's what Mark says next that piques investigators' interest.
Is there anybody that I can talk to? Because I think I know who did it.
Let me get a detective. Stay right here for me, okay?
Yes, thank you.
I believe that there's a certain person that had a fallen out with Jonathan, and I believe that they had a motive.
Mark tells detectives he doesn't think that the crime was a robbery gone bad, but rather the brutal byproduct of a love triangle gone horribly awry.
I said, this is the person that may have involvement in Jonathan's death.
Detectives in Silver Spring, Maryland are just hours into the investigation of the brutal home invasion murder of 26-year-old Jonathan Harris. Their initial theory is that Jonathan was killed in a robbery gone wrong, and that Jonathan likely knew his assailant.
Police realize whoever robbed Jonathan also took his credit cards.
We start looking into bank information to see if people are out using a stolen credit card.
However, just as investigators begin working the robbery angle, Jonathan's friend, Mark Newey, has shown up at the crime scene and claims to have information that may contradict this theory.
Officer says that you may know what happened to Jonathan.
I think so. There's this old friend of ours that got into an argument with Jonathan about a year ago.
I was thinking that this friend had something to do with Jonathan's death.
Police start talking to Jonathan's friend and find out there was this one guy, Dwayne Carter, and both of them were vying for the same girl, and there was some tension there.
He was one of our close friends growing up. They had a disagreement over a certain girl, and I know that they didn't get along after they had that disagreement.
The girl was named Sheena Coleman.
Jonathan was basically being friendly with her like he was with everyone, but Dwayne wasn't having it.
According to Mark, one day in 2013, things got extra heated between Dwayne and Jonathan.
Hey, Harris, better stay away from Sheena.
Dwayne, chill, man. All right, we're just friends. That's it.
I'm not playing.
We're just friends.
I'm dead serious. Stay away from Sheena, or you'll regret it.
Okay, Dwayne.
Believe that.
Okay.
After that incident, Jonathan didn't talk to her. He just wanted to stay out of it.
Since Samantha had entered Jonathan's life not long after that, Mark assumed the incident between him and Dwayne Carter was old news. But now that Jonathan has been murdered, Mark wonders if Dwayne had finally made good on his threats.
I believe that he had a motive to hurt Jonathan. I said this is the person that may have involvement in Jonathan's death.
After speaking with Mark Newey, uniformed officers fan out across Silver Spring in search of Dwayne Carter. Back at the station, with a subpoena for Jonathan's bank records approved, detectives begin scrubbing through recent transactions on his accounts.
Wait a minute. Credit card was used on the day he was murdered.
We see on December 5th at like 10:17, his card was used in Frederick at a gas station.
But without an established time of death, it's impossible to know whether this transaction was made by Jonathan or his killer.
His mother last talked to him on Friday, December 5th in the morning.
His body's discovered on the 6th, so we don't know the precise moment that his life ends.
To determine whether or not it was Jonathan who used the credit card, detectives head to the gas station in nearby Frederick and ask the manager to pull surveillance footage.
And we're right there.
It is immediately apparent to investigators that Jonathan Harris was not the person using that credit card.
The guy in the video was over 6 foot tall, 250 pounds, and Jonathan was around 5'7", and he had a smaller frame. It just didn't seem like the same person.
But that's not all.
The surveillance then shows an African-American female exit the SUV.
She's dressed with knee-high boots, a black jacket, and she's carrying a Redskins purse, which was pretty distinctive.
Both return to the same vehicle and take off.
The video of the two suspects provides police with their best lead yet. This also allows investigators to pinpoint the time when Jonathan was actually murdered.
Jonathan last spoke to his mother at 8:32 a.m. and the transaction is at 10:17 a.m. It takes approximately an hour to get to the gas station in Frederick from the Harris residence. So I would say that this occurred 9:17, 9:20.
Even though financial transactions and security video have enabled investigators to determine Jonathan's time of death, the identity of the two suspects remains a mystery. So police pulled Dwayne Carter's license photo to compare it to the security footage.
He's not the same person they're seeing in the surveillance video.
But if Dwayne Carter isn't the man in the video, Who is?
The investigators are able to identify a tag number associated with this vehicle.
The tag number leads detectives to an individual named Dion Sabatker.
Detectives then pulled up the driver's license belonging to Dion Sabatker.
He matches the male seen in the surveillance video.
Detectives wonder if maybe the female passenger is Samantha Parker. After all, they've been looking for her since learning she moved out of Jonathan's apartment 2 weeks prior. But identifying the woman in the video is easier said than done.
Detectives worry if they go talk to Dion that he'll alert the woman, and then she'll skip town, and then they'll have a harder time trying to identify who she is.
The following morning, detectives decide to put Dion Sabatker under surveillance.
They were watching to see if Dion attempted to sell any property they suspected he'd stolen from Jonathan's house.
Police also hoped that Dion would eventually make contact with the unknown female suspect from the surveillance video.
Dion Sabatker never attempts to sell any of the suspected stolen goods, nor does he lead police to the unidentified woman in the video. After 3 days of tailing Dion, detectives try another approach.
We were able to obtain Dion's cell phone records. There's like 50 calls to this number on the day of the murder. So we subpoena that number. We find out it belongs to LaToya Morgan.
Detectives stop in their tracks when they pull a photo of LaToya.
She's the one who's in the video.
This was a critical moment in the investigation. The police now can link the male suspect, the female suspect, and the vehicle in question that was seen on surveillance video.
Detectives are inching closer and closer to solving the murder of Jonathan Harris. Unfortunately, several essential questions still remain unanswered.
Did Jonathan know these two people? It seems like he must have, because there was no forced entry. Why else would he have let these people into his house willingly?
The truth will turn out to be far more sinister than investigators ever imagined, and will ultimately ensnare a mysterious third suspect no one ever saw coming.
That was a puzzle. It makes no sense. I wasn't even trying to process what happened.
How can you predict something like that?
December 13th, 2014. Detectives in Silver Spring, Maryland have been investigating the death of beloved local resident, Jonathan Harris.
We're talking to Jonathan's friends. We're trying to figure out his time frame, who he hangs out with. Does he have any problems with anyone? So we can have a direction to go in our investigation.
At first glance, it looked like Jonathan was the victim of a deadly armed robbery. But when Jonathan's mother revealed to police that he and his girlfriend, Samantha Parker, had recently broken up, Samantha instantly became a person of interest.
He said, "We're not together anymore. She's not here anymore." And then our lives changed.
Police were trying to find Samantha, but they hadn't been able to track her down at that point. So in the meantime, they tracked down Jonathan's stolen credit cards and uncovered two suspects, Dion Sabatker and LaToya Morgan.
On December 22nd, 3 weeks after Jonathan's murder, detectives secure arrest warrants for Dion and LaToya, along with search warrants for their homes. It doesn't take detectives long to find Dion.
Dion was actually arrested in Fiji County on an unrelated charge and was transferred from Prince George's County to Montgomery County.
With Dion in custody, detectives set their sights on LaToya.
LaToya Morgan is seen near her residence. She's arrested and brought back to headquarters.
Before interviewing their suspects, detectives initiate a search of Dion's residence and quickly turn up evidence that could potentially tie him to Jonathan's murder.
We were able to retrieve a pair of black and white tennis shoes. They appear to be the same shoes worn in the video surveillance. When we seize them and we analyze them, it turns out that there's a small blood sample on the inner left shoe.
Police are wondering, could this be Jonathan's blood?
Investigators send the shoes out for DNA testing.
The other key piece of evidence that we recovered was a PlayStation.
That was quite significant because Jonathan had a Sony PlayStation 3 stolen from his residence during the robbery murder.
Back at the station, detectives check the PlayStation serial number. It's a match to the one stolen from Jonathan's apartment. However, a subsequent search of LaToya's home fails to uncover forensic evidence connecting her to Jonathan's murder.
All right, LaToya, do you know Jonathan Harris?
No, I don't.
Tell us about the day of December 5th.
So I needed a ride to a funeral, so I called Dion.
Dion Sabacro could be almost an unofficial cab. He gives people rides in exchange for money. She secures a ride on the date in question, in which he agrees to take her to the area near the funeral.
LaToya says that Dion picked her up early that morning, but he wasn't alone.
LaToya got in a car, and in the car was a woman.
LaToya says she didn't know this woman, but figured she was just another one of Dion's paying customers.
But LaToya tells detectives that it didn't take long to realize the woman was more than just another cab fare.
So I get in the car, and there's a girl in the back. She said she wants to get high, so I said, why not? She said she would pay for it.
LaToya admits that she and Dion took the woman up on her offer.
Dion pulled over on a corner where he knew a dealer, and this woman bought them all dippers, which is basically PCP-laced marijuana.
LaToya says that after smoking the dipper, she began drifting in and out of consciousness. However, she claims she heard snippets of a conversation between the woman and Dion.
LaToya says they were talking about a guy who the woman knew who lived in a basement apartment, and she was asking Dion to take her over to his place.
She said that she wanted to get some of her property back.
Next thing I know, I pass out. I wake up, and we're in some neighborhood, and they're getting out the car.
LaToya claims that Dion and the woman were heading toward the door of what appeared to be a basement apartment.
About 15 minutes later, I see Dion coming out, and he's holding a TV in his arms, and the girl's holding a bag full of stuff.
She did observe them bringing property out of the residence and put it in the back of the car.
It became apparent to LaToya that the credit card they were using and the property they had taken belonged to the guy in the house, and it looked like they had robbed this guy.
So then we left, went to the gas station, and then after the gas station, he took me to the funeral and dropped me off.
As for the other woman in the car, LaToya says she never saw her again.
LaToya really didn't think about what happened until she saw Jonathan's house on the news a few days later. It was then that she confronted Dion, and he more or less admitted to robbing Jonathan, but he never admitted to killing Jonathan.
Thankfully, LaToya isn't done talking, and what she says next will blow the case wide open.
Throughout that time, did Dion ever tell you her name?
Yes.
It's been nearly 3 weeks since the brutal murder of Jonathan Harris, and investigators are questioning suspect LaToya Morgan. LaToya claims that she stayed in Dion Sabatka's car while he and another woman entered Jonathan's home.
They go into the residence. She doesn't know what transpired inside the residence, but then she observes them coming out with a duffel bag and the large screen TV.
When detectives press LaToya on the unidentified suspect's name, she makes a jaw-dropping revelation.
Did Dion ever tell you her name?
Yes, he did.
What was that?
Samantha.
Detectives believe that the Samantha LaToya is referring to is Jonathan's ex-girlfriend, Samantha Parker, who they've been unable to locate since his murder. With LaToya's statement in tow, detectives in Silver Spring immediately issue a statewide APB for Samantha Parker. While they wait, they turn their attention to Dion Sabatker.
We did interview him, but he elected not to give a statement.
With Dion refusing to talk, finding Samantha becomes more important than ever. Thankfully, Samantha and Jonathan's friend, Farron Conward, comes forward with new information.
We interviewed Farron Conward, and what I learned from Farron is that she actually introduced Jonathan to Samantha. She has known Samantha for a long time.
They really vibed off of music, and they liked the same thing. They were both risk takers. They loved the same movies. They just clicked.
But Farron says she tried to dissuade Jonathan from pursuing Samantha.
Farron had tried to warn Jonathan about Samantha. She let him know that Samantha could be a lot of fun, but she was also very self-destructive, and she was into a lot of hardcore drugs.
At first, Farron believed that Jonathan heeded her advice, but she learned the truth a few weeks later when she saw the couple together.
Jonathan and Samantha dated secretly without me even knowing.
they didn't share it with her because Jonathan knew what she would say.
It wasn't right. She wasn't the one.
She knew Samantha to be someone who continuously took advantage of people, and she had her own concerns about Jonathan being taken advantage of.
She would get Mr. Harris to buy her a cell phone and pay for the bill every month.
If you asked Jonathan, they were dating. Samantha tended to look at Jonathan more as, I have somewhere to stay.
It also appeared that Samantha had been hiding her drug habit from Jonathan. She seemed like this fun-loving girl who liked to drink and have fun, but really she was on much harder drugs than alcohol.
According to Farron, things only got worse when Samantha was arrested and charged with theft.
He would visit her often, and I remember him coming to my house like 2 o'clock in the morning, just talking about how he wishes that she would just do better and how he was gonna help her.
Farron tells police that after Samantha's release from jail in April 2014, she continued her wild ways. This time, Jonathan seemed to have had enough.
I remember Jonathan calling me. He's getting more and more frustrated with her because she's still living that lifestyle that got her in jail in the first place.
According to Farron, the last straw came in November of 2014 when Jonathan discovered that Samantha had been using drugs inside his apartment.
What is this? Samantha, I told you couldn't be doing this in my house.
A what? You gonna get your mommy to come down here and spank me?
Samantha, she's the type of person that doesn't like to be told what to do.
Pack your stuff and get out. It's over.
He felt as though she wasn't going to change. She wasn't trying to be a better person.
Farron also tells police that on the heels of the breakup with Samantha, Jonathan's murder did seem suspicious, but she was too shaken up to put two and two together.
I couldn't make sense out of anything. I was in shock.
But Farron states what prompted her to come forward was a conversation she just remembered, one she had with Samantha less than 48 hours before Jonathan's murder.
Samantha Parker felt that she had been treated unfairly and being thrown out of that apartment.
She implied that she could make things happen, that she could have people take care of him.
Samantha is a vengeful person, but I didn't think that she would go to that far of an extent.
With Farron Conward's statement in tow, investigators are now certain that Samantha Parker is responsible for the murder of Jonathan Harris. Thankfully, detectives have been able to track down where Samantha is staying, and later that day, they arrest her at a friend's apartment.
We ended up arresting Samantha on December 22nd.
Back at the station, detectives confront Samantha with Latoya Morgan's statement, as well as that of her friend, Farron Conward.
Tell me about the day of his murder.
Samantha admitted that she and Dion went to Jonathan's house to collect her belongings on December 5th, but said she never had any intention on robbing or killing Jonathan at all.
What happened to Jonathan? How did he die?
Look, I didn't get out the car. Dion and Latoya went inside. I don't know what else you want me to tell you.
She says she never got out of the car. She never went in the residence.
Samantha claimed Dion and Latoya were the ones who killed Jonathan because they went inside the house while she waited outside.
Detectives aren't buying Samantha's story.
That just doesn't make sense because Jonathan doesn't know Dion or Latoya, so why would he even open the door for them? What would make sense would be if Samantha walked up to the residence and he was like, oh, it's Samantha, and opened the door.
Given the stolen items, the use of the credit card, the blood on Dion's shoes, the statement from Latoya, the fact that they were all there during the time of Jonathan's death was enough for detectives to throw the book at all three suspects.
On December 23rd, 18 days after Jonathan Harris's death, police charged Latoya Morgan, Dion Sabatker, and Samantha Parker with burglary, conspiracy to commit burglary, and first-degree murder. When news of Samantha's arrest reaches Jonathan's friends and family, they're relieved.
You know, he'd give you the shirt off his back. I think he just gave his shirt to the wrong person.
The mere fact that she would do something so cruel to murder him like that and to leave his body on the floor like that, it's crazy.
But will Jonathan's friends and family ever see Samantha and her alleged co-conspirators face justice? Or will a bizarre twist derail the trials before they even begin?
Damn it, I want you in trial. I want you to hear what you did. I want you to hear the pain that you caused.
Police in Silver Spring, Maryland have charged three suspects in the murder of Jonathan Harris. Latoya Morgan, Dion Sabatker, and Jonathan's ex-girlfriend, Samantha Parker.
It was Samantha Parker's idea that they go to this home to take items that are in the home because she had been kicked out of that apartment.
Proving Samantha was the ringleader will require prosecutors to rely on the testimony of several key witnesses. None more important than Samantha's co-defendant, Latoya Morgan.
Latoya Morgan's testimony was critical. She, through counsel, was able to secure a plea agreement.
Latoya pleads guilty to accomplice after the fact and receives a sentence of 5 years in exchange for her testimony.
She was able to provide critical information that linked Samantha and Dion to Jonathan.
Latoya's testimony, coupled with a lengthy evidence list, has prosecutors feeling confident heading into the trials of Dion Sabatker and Samantha Parker. But in December 2015, 3 months before the proceedings are scheduled to begin, a shocking turn of events rocks the case.
Samantha Parker died of brain cancer.
When she went into custody, no one knew that she had any kind of illness. Very shortly after being diagnosed, she passed away. It was upsetting to us to not be able to bring everyone to justice who was involved in this crime.
I was angry that she died before the trial. She needed to hear what she did, because I don't think she understood.
When I heard that she had passed, I felt exactly the same as I did before hearing, as I did after. That was the moment when I realized there was no moving on. There's only learning to live with this.
Thankfully, Dion Sabatker is more than healthy enough to stand trial. On March 2, 2016, prosecutors present their opening arguments.
The state believes that Samantha Parker and Dion Sabatker entered Jonathan Harris's apartment with every intent to rob him of his belongings.
Get the TV and the gangsters!
Jonathan may have put up a fight.
Whoa, whoa! Hey, yo, dog, where you going?
Prosecutors argued that Dion and Samantha, being under the influence of PCP, altered their mental state and likely intensified the situation.
Jonathan is diminutive in size. Sabatka is a substantially bigger, stronger man who could have easily, physically overpowered Jonathan.
He was ultimately strangled by Dion Sabatker with the help, possibly, of Samantha Parker.
Prosecutors claim that in addition to choking Jonathan, Samantha and Dion also beat him.
Go get the rest of the stuff.
There was some blood that, as a result of the beating and the struggle that took place.
They then take exactly what they came for, his belongings, his money, his wallet, and they leave together.
The physical evidence collected inside Dion's apartment, along with Latoya Morgan's testimony, make for a rock-solid case.
One bingo in this case is a pair of shoes. And on those shoes, there's a drop of blood. And that drop of blood, through DNA testing, comes back belonging to our victim, Jonathan.
There's no other explanation as to why Jonathan's DNA would be on Dion's shoe, unless he was inside the residence.
The jury convicted him relatively quickly. And he was found guilty of first-degree murder.
Judge said 40 years to life. The district attorneys had prepared me for 25, 30, but he said 40. I was like, whoa.
After handing down Dion's sentence, the judge takes time to acknowledge that Jonathan Harris lived an extraordinary life.
He said, "Miss Harris, I want to tell you, the world has lost a good friend, a loyal and giving individual. The world should have more Jonathans."
Jonathan already endured so much and overcome so much in his short life, and he had such promise. He was so talented, and we don't get to see that or hear it or see where he could go in life.
He was loved by many. He was a special person to a lot of people, and a lot of people are never going to get over that.
His loss is huge, but his legacy is going to live through the people who got to know him.